we can go to a pub and we can drink a beer and we can come up with many ideas. But to take an idea and to take the consequences of the idea and to take all the ins and outs and to fill in, to make it work, and to do all the whole trajectory, the whole story, that is quite really something. And then it becomes something. So again, concept, idea, so easy to say, but it has to be exactly it, and it you only can reach by exploring, looking, testing, training, and then you'll find it.
Being Dutch and being taught design sort of halfway through the 90s, of course, Droog was a big thing happening at the time. And what I more and more notice is that there's a lot of people, a lot of designers that think that before they start designing, they have to have a good concept. And I think you should have a good feeling about something, why you want to do a project. And this feeling is a concept. But a concept is not like an A4 piece of paper written out of what and why and who and some research. So you start a project, and then afterwards, when you're finished, you start. You can talk about it, or you can reflect on it, or halfway you reflect on it. But you never should just start by words only. And also, as soon as you can explain something to the full 100%. You don't have to make it because you can explain it. And for me, the reason for making products is that you want to share something with somebody that you cannot put in a book or in a picture, but you have to put it in a chair or a light. So words could never, they say a picture says more than 1,000 words, but a chair can also say more than 5 pictures or it's, depends on what medium you want to talk in as a creative person.
What is so typically Dutch is that from the moment you're from school, you can immediately shout out, hey, Gijs Bakker, he's crazy, and I know it better, and I do this, and that. You can't have a big mouth. Because, how can I explain it? Like, in our culture, you know, everybody has the right to do what he wants to, and he gets also opportunities. What you see in Italy, it's like for the first 10 years, you know, you are there in the corner and the big designer is saying, hey, wait, maybe you can do the button and then, you know, like, and that's, they are already in that situation. I think on one hand, I really like it because I'm this old fashioned way of thinking that I think, you know, first learning and then talk. But on the other hand, you see what is happening is that design directions can all of a sudden, and that is what's happening in the Netherlands, grow very fast because the Droog design, of course, Gijs, one of the founders of, you know, is could exist because of the young guys who are not afraid of saying the Italian design, fuck off, sorry, we do it differently, you know, like we have our own approach, we do it in a totally different way. We don't care that they are already, you know, standing there or a very high level. We were very tiny and we're saying, hey, listen, why all this crazy design? Do it simple, you know. And we could say it here. We could, we had the opportunity, and of course that was also a bit of government money, you know, to go to Italy, to stand there in the Milan in the presentation. Gijs was there and Rennie at the same, you know, showing all this work. All of a sudden, the very young designers in between the very big Italian designers, and this is typically Dutch, that is possible. In Italy, it would be never be possible. Because the youngsters are then, you know, moved in the corner. And that's I think the biggest difference that you can see that in the Netherlands, for everybody who's just having 5 minutes his degree or even none, could say something about design and it's allowed to. You know, there is not a kind of golden rule like you don't talk about the big designers.
Just a little funny experience I had in 1980 when I was invited by officials here in Holland to make an exhibition about Dutch design, which I thought, how is it Dutch design? We have nothing. I know some of the young students that are doing interesting stuff. I know an architect, I know a fashion designer, I know. And then, okay, I've said, well, to get a commission is fantastic because you get money and you have a deadline. So in 3 months' time, they needed an exhibition in Germany, it was. So then, after all this talk about all the problems with design in this country, how difficult it is with industries, etc., I thought I'd do it the other way around. I'm not going to look to the industries, but I'm going to look to the individual designers and try to bring them on stage as an individual who is creating.
What I think is really Dutch is a kind of course, yeah, that's the mentality, not to be able to be proud or to brag about your own qualities, which is completely against our Calvinist culture. You are absolutely not important. And so you just you work hard, you do your best, but you will never say, like in America, when you try to get a new job, I'm the one you need, you know? Like, this is what I can do.
It's not accepted in Holland if you come with a Ferrari. Like then in Italy it is, hey, everybody goes a thumbs up, hey, you're a cool guy that you have a Ferrari. Here in Holland, totally.
No, the opposite. Yeah,
yeah. So we are in between, so we'll not drive with a Ferrari.
I think you can interpret it being modest at a certain way.
Yeah.
The opposite for us is not arrogant.
No.
Being not modest is saying believe in your ideas,
yeah,
and make sure that everybody, until they get bored of you, knows what your mind is thinking. I think that is the way of what I see in modest. We also not walk on the streets with sunglasses.
No, we're the great designers. No.
I think we're the modest people and designers that an artist or whatever you want to label us can be, because we're also in the same culture as you. We're not doing this, you know.
No, that you're in a pub where there's no sunlight and then with big sunglasses.
Yeah, yeah.
Awareness about how we live our life. That's the main thing where I want to talk about. And this awareness can be in a very tiny tiny detail in a product, but it can also be just in a more general story.
Okay, design and storytelling. It's nothing else than telling a story. And or you told it good and everybody likes it, or you told it bad and nobody likes it.
There are some people that when you're in a group, let's do it with a campfire or in a cafe, there are some people that are very good at storytelling, that you wish you had that talent. And they can even tell your story better. That's the same with design, but then shaping it.
There is something extra. But the moment when you think that you make a chair and it's more than just that chair, there is something extra. There is, but that's exactly the thing that I don't want to put too much words to, because it will. It will take away the magic. It would be. I'd rather have you come up with the story, or anyone who uses it. I know there's. It's a bit like you can tell a story, but then I'd rather talk about poetry, where at least you can interpret those few words that are given into your own story or your own, and you make it fit into your own life. And actually, I'm not a big fan of that type of design, which is about storytelling, which is only one meaning for one product, and you just have to get the artist or the designer's opinion into your, you have to like it or not. And I think it's very often better if you just do just a little step backwards and just give ingredients for as many stories as you can come up with.
For designers, it's really hard to make something ugly because they want to control the outcome. They want to make something beautiful. But try to make something ugly once. It's great. You should do it. It's really, really important to break away from your own traditions as a designer, because you cannot make only beautiful stuff. And sometimes you make, when you try to make something ugly 5 times in a row, you will end up making something beautiful without knowing it.
Design, then I immediately say daily life. That's the only reaction that I have. Just design is not, you know, making this extraordinary shape. The starting point is daily life. And from there you get maybe to the extraordinary shape.
We didn't speak about humor, irony. Also, this is something that has been always connected with Droog design and later as part of Dutch design. And also, this is very dangerous. The same as if you say simple, simplicity. Simple can also mean nothing, can be just emptiness. And then it doesn't work. And it's the same with humor. I think we have learned that an aspect you can use to communicate better, to bring some lightness in your expression, in your thoughts. And humor is a tool to reach the audience better. And one of the things what I always discovered in our presentations with Droog design is this kind of enlightenment what people get when they look at our products, because it gives a little smile on the face. It's not humor, it's a little smile. And if you analyze it, it's often based on recognition. Recognition because it remembers you of your grandmother maybe. It remembers you of something you have been reading about. That gives a very nice feeling and a very nice recognition.
I was asked by RTL Plus, they had this child program, this German television. They had this child program where they did this event every year, and then when the kids were coming, they were giving them standard mug with a print, and they said, well, can you do something better? Well, something worse is impossible, so it always would have been better. And at that time, my oldest son was like 2 or 3 years old. So I thought, yeah, it would be fantastic if you make a mug which scales up the movement of drinking. So when this little kid is drinking, the movement is like this. It's like this really big movement. This is the width of a 3-year-old child. So the movement of drinking is really blown up. That was the idea. And it was a big success from the beginning. For me, the most important is that when you look at it, you get a smile on your face. But it's also ergonomic wonder, because you really can hold it. So if I have a hangover in the morning, I have to drink the coffee with this cup. Otherwise, I cannot drink coffee.
was a famous Italian, I believe it was Sotsas, who said that the chair is the canvas for all designers. And we tried to think, okay, we need something, so let's do a chair. So there's no really big thought after chair. The only thing we want to prove with this is that you can actually, from movement, create a three-dimensional shape. It can also be a building, it can also be jewelry, I don't know what. The thing is, as designers, we not so much designed a product, we designed a process. And the chair was very lo-fi. We just used two cameras from a PlayStation and used a little plastic transparent model and put an ant on it. And the first model is here. So this was the first model in which the model was not really shaped really, really nicely, but it resembled a chair. So to us, it's much more to think about processes, and when you rethink processes, you are also able to come up with new outcomes, new output, new products, new ideas. And from those ideas, you can come to the next idea and the next idea, and so on. So that to us is innovation.
Like the first time I went to Milan in 2000, I walked onto the stand of Cassina and I saw this chair and I thought, wow, this is the best thing they made this year. And it was a chair called Ayo by Deganello, but it turned out to be made in 1967. So I thought it was something very modern, but it was something already very old. But the great thing about the Ayo from Deganello is that he has you're sitting on a pillow, but you're leaning into this big piece of textile, and the textile is suspended on two flat strips of steel that flex in this way, but don't flex too much in that way. So it's really, really comfortable chair. And I bought a house last year, and the first thing I bought for myself to put in the house was the Ayo from Deganello.
I want a chair for 25 years. I don't want to have a chair in a lime and next year it's red. What is the color? You know, it's if we talk about durability, for example, you know, we have these big discussions and cradle to cradle this and that and that and that, and then I see a very fashionable chair or a table that I think, yeah, okay, now it's nice, but in 2 years it's not nice anymore. It will not fit your interior because you're changing, you know? Like, so you can also approach it from a totally different direction, not in the materials, but in the product on itself. If you, for example, also this, I use leather in it, and if you sit on it, it gets brown and a bit, you know? But it also says, it's my chair. And when it's my chair and it's broken, I repair it because I love the chair. Instead of that it's a plastic thing around it, it's never changing, and I think, yeah, well, it's just a chair from everybody. These things, I see the next step to durability, you know, to make the products where you still, that you want to carry with you for a very long time. And then, of course, you know, some maybe say, yeah, the wood that you are using, this is just a prototype, of course, yeah, I use the oak and other materials, but it's not really good for the environment. But then I think, well, if I make a chair and I give it the feeling that you want to have it for a very long time, you know, and you do have it because the materials are asking for it, then I see that as a better perspective. So it's always a very large discussion. And I think, especially if you talk about technology and about durability, it's always getting the technology talk. But I think it should be much more the behavior talk. Because the behavior nowadays is just, you know, use it, throw it away, use it, throw it away. It's a very, very, very fast system where we're working in and live in. So that's actually the basic thought about this thing. And there you see also maybe the difference is that this is the starting of my approach. If I go to a factory and tell this story, they think, yeah, all nice, but I don't care, you know, I want to sell products. It's like, this is my, how can I call it, the art starting off moment. And afterwards, when I have this thing done and I have my story told and I made this first ones myself, and there is a manufacturer and he's saying, well, I just like it for the chair that it is, I think all fine. But it needs to start for myself from this story that I want to bring out and explain, like, okay, people, I want to go actually back to this very fundamental knowledge of how do you make a chair? It's just a bundle of beams, this story.
First idea, actually, how we came to the shape, is I thought, okay, if you wanted 64 lights, or in this case 63 lights, because the first light was 64, you take a bundle of 64 energy cables, tape them, and you split them up into four bundles of 16, tape them up, and then you open them in four bundles of four. So in total, you can have a chandelier of 64 lights. And this is the design that I delivered to Moy. So there, the way of making dictates everything within light, and you follow a natural structure. The nice thing about this project is that what I thought was a good and handy way to make something, it wasn't. And halfway through, Massa Wonders came and said, "Well, I don't think it's still too much soldering going on in all the open ends of 64 LEDs." And says, "But I have an idea that I'm working on for a light with floss that we could use very well for your light." And because this light only needs to be wired here and there. And the secret is that it's a metal structure and it's painted twice. So it's painted with a plastic paint, and then it's painted with I think it's a brass or copper paint, which will guide the currency. So you just they designed a special snap-on LED that you can snap on every end, as long as it's stripped, and the LED lights up. And the nice thing about it is that Marcel Wander's light didn't happen because there was still a lot of bugs in it. But one of the problems they had, which was made this shape perfect, was that of course the paint has a little bit more resistance than a normal copper wire. So the distance from the electricity point to the LED point should always be the same distance. Within that structure, this is how that worked. So for me, this is also a bit thinking textiles in a way that you start with something small, you start with an element and you see how you can multiply it into a shape.
He was seeing that his craftsmanship of the company was not in interest of people anymore. So you saw that the company was slowly going down. He was thinking, listen, this is not going to happen to me. You know, he's carrying the name of the company for, you know, it's the oldest factory of the Netherlands. It's in early days, you know, they brought the tiles, the roof tiles, you know, and the stones glaciered from Makkum by boat sailing to Amsterdam, you know. So this is really an old company. And he was seeing down that, you know, world is changing. And then he thought, okay, need to do something, let's bring in this. And he started this off with Hella, also a good friend of mine, this idea of, okay, let's work with designers, bring it in a new world, make these combinations between craft and the designer. And so slowly, you know, step by step, he made it possible for himself to survive and get new attention to the work that he's doing. And now you see that he's, from the design, he's growing to this architect, you know, he's making lots of tiles now for buildings and stuff. And I think, you know, this has a lot to do with daring, dare to be a company who's saying, okay, I'm going for it, you know, and nobody did it before, but I'm trying to. And this is what is important. What I try to explain about stove manufacturing companies, if you say, I have a stove and there's concrete around, they say, yeah, we work with steel. Yeah, who cares, you know, we also do the other part, let's find out. But they're not willing. And this is exactly the part that Jan did. Okay, never worked with designers before. They're a pain in the ass, but I'm trying. You know, and he did a good job. So it's also daring to do things.
Dick Van Hoff's name came up very clearly because, in our opinion, he is somebody who has the function very solidly incorporated in his design mentality. So he came up with this. So he came up with this is was the first thing. So this actually is the reinterpretation of a very traditional library lamp, and a very archetypical thing. And he added this wood, which you can't do in ceramics. You could do it, but then it won't be adjustable. And this had a very nice appeal. And he said himself, "Well, this is what he likes best, because it makes you focused. When you have this lamp and you work on it, the only thing you can do is have a small book beneath it, or an A4 folio piece of paper beneath it. But that's not how we work. We use our old desk. So from a functional point of view, today you need another lamp which is higher up, which has a broader beam of light. So this was the second one to come up. And then a whole series, which is called Work, appeared, adding a pen box and a clock, and eventually vase, because this wasn't the purpose of the whole project. But he said, "I don't want the vase, Jan, I want the vase added, because the vase you have are all vases. And what I like best, when I go to the flower shop, you have those buckets with tulips and with plants, and that's the way I like to see the flowers best. So I want to design a bucket. This is just a bucket with a hand thing. You can take this thing out, cut your flowers, put it back in, and use it." So it's very usable. It has a very it has an appeal that you clearly understand immediately what it's for. So it has a very nice button. He takes much care in defining those details. This is used in ships. It's like on the desk. It's sort of water resistant thing, but also these knobs. He's very specific about that, and that's what we like. So he has the same mentality from a designer's point of view as we have from a manufacturing point of view.
We saw these beautiful chandeliers in a movie. From these garden chandeliers, really with candles, we thought would not be great to make like a waterproof chandelier that you can hang in your bathroom, outside your garden,
in a tree, in a sauna,
anywhere. Yeah. And then we came up with different designs, and this is one of the later prototypes. First, we made cardboard models, so we sketch them, we cut it out, and we make like I think 25 different chandeliers. And we just looked at them all day, and then together with some freelancers and interns, we slowly moved it to this way.
Yeah.
First, we had even crystals.
Yeah. Plastic crystals.
Plastic crystals.
It really was not.
No. So and then suddenly the Fatboy, the director, came, Alex Bergman, and he said, "Why don't we cut them off?" And then we cut them off at the meeting, and suddenly. Now we're getting happy. So we're not only, you know, I'm really happy even if I don't know, the cleaner comes by and says, "Does this not work better?"
We're not open like, for that. No? Yeah. Again, that ego thing. That some people start worrying, "Oh, but then it's not my idea."
Whatever.
Like, it's a better idea, no? Yeah. Let's collaborate in that sense. I cannot paint. So it's no problem to just get the best painters in the world, say, "We did this with all of us. I needed you. Yeah. I just made an ID."
Yeah.
Collaborate.
Collaborate, yeah.
So that's for us also design, to collaborate with different people.
And talents.
Yeah. And design is collaborating anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. If you can't collaborate as a designer, you must be or damn brilliant or very lonely.
Yeah.
I'm not a guy who makes things into statements or laws, but during my own career, I came up with one simple finding, is that success is nothing more or nothing less than talent that is big enough to work together. I mean, I guess that's basically it. Try to be honest to your talent and learn how to work together.
So there's a need for authenticity
So something needs to look authentic in order for it to exist, because designers think that people might relate to it. And then the authentic part is that something should be handmade, or that it should rather look like it's handmade. So it doesn't need to be handmade, but it can be mass-produced, but even look handmade. And it's screaming. Of course, that falls apart in different categories as well. Then there's the objects that are screaming for attention, that want to be new. Huh? So it's new, and then therefore it can exist, or it can only exist that it's new. And then there's a need for new. All these magazines need to be sold, of course. So there's a reproductive value of that particular product as well. It can be a one-off. It can be one of a kind. But through these magazines, it's being reproduced as well, even though it's not a mass-produced product.
And I was commissioned, I think it was 1996, commissioned by a very popular department store here in Holland, HEMA. And they're very interesting because they have cheap, functional, good objects. And one of the products I designed was, and one of the questions was to design dish mop. And then I think, a dish mop, okay, but then you have to use a plastic holder and the hair, because it's, that means you have an enormous investment in a steel mold for injection molding. And I just thought, this is nonsense, why? I mean, it's such a simple action, why can't we avoid it? That's how it starts. And then I look around and I see in the shop, I see a round soft ball that children play with. Later I also discovered that people use it when they have arthritic problem with their fingers to train their fingers. It was around, but I mean, after a while, but when you put it in this steel and you close it, then you easily can wash the dishes, and then later you can throw it away and put another one in it. And if you don't use it anymore, you can use it for your barbecue, and because this is simple stainless steel that will last forever. So if you, it's for me like a joke to bring back what it is all about. Why should it be injection molded and all these investments? Why can't it be in a simple way? They sold a lot of them, but at a certain moment it seemed still to be too difficult for the public, and then we took it in the collection of Droog Design. So when I want to buy a new one, I go to Droog and buy the next dish mop.
The sustainability of an idea as well. It's not a material that's just sustainable, but an idea can be sustainable as well. If you think too shallow about a concept, it will not sustain. For instance, we do identities for a brand or a product. If you like do what the client says, like forget about the analysis and forget about the research, just make a logo. You just start out making a logo. It has no story, has no fundament. So you have maybe it looks nice, but it's not sustainable after like 2 years, because then you say, okay, maybe it was too much a trend at that time to do it this way. So that's why you need this to build a foundation, and the result will be something, I don't know what, but a shape without foundation has no meaning.
What I learned about design was that it's only a tool to help industry. So the industry has a problem, the designer is there to help to solve the problem. That's it. And I always have thought, but this is crazy, because the industry is helping us. It's dealing about us, about human beings. We need, we don't need much, but if we need, good products, intelligent products. And I think it's very important to make this shift, to turn it around. And it is not the industry, but it is the human being who needs it.
If it's, yeah, if this was produced 20 times a year, this would cost 600 euros. It's produced in the millions, but therefore this is also not ceramic, this is not hand-painted, this is not... So, I don't love this thing. If it's empty, it's gone. And I think the most important thing is, if you buy something that costs, like a lamp from Dick van Hoff, costs 400 euros or something like that, every time you're gonna sit down, you're gonna smile a little bit more.
Yeah.
So what is happiness worth to you?
But still it remains that the designer is a designer, so we have to do... If we work together, we have to do our part of the job, and we have to be able to be and to have the skills to give form. It's very old-fashioned to say to give form, but maybe you have heard that the Dutch word for design is vormgeven, form giving, which is, I like it. It's still a good thing. It's a good thing to realize that, because we have to communicate this.
You shouldn't characterize it by saying that we use recycled wood, or that we recycle in general, or that we take iconic shapes and then do it in another material. Or I mean, those are all the stereotypes about Dutch design.
To me, I think design is the way usable objects are shaped, are constructed. It's definitely, I think, everything in our daily lives is designed, either by scientists or by artists. We're completely surrounded by it.
Yeah, translated in Dutch, we have a word for it, spullen. And spullen, yeah, translates to stuff.